please. It's good to see everyone over here in the Lord's house this morning. All of you right here. Bless our newlyweds. We're glad they're here this morning. We had a good time yesterday. Some fun this morning. Anyhow, take your Bibles. Turn to the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 2. We're going to be looking at the first 8 verses, working particularly with the first 3, and focusing primarily, and in addition to that, first 3 verses, we're going to be kind of hanging around verse number 2 for a little extended period of time. If you're able to stand and would like to honor God's word as it's read, I invite you to do so at this time as I read from the King James Version, the Gospel of Jesus Christ, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 says, "Thou therefore, my son," now if you're a Bible marker like I am, and I hope all of you are, sometimes my Bible, and I trust many of yours, is the same way. It's got so many marks, I can't hardly read the words in it. But if you're a Bible marker, I would encourage you to mark 4 or 5 phrases in this in these 8 verses. First one being, be strong. Verse 1, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong." Now remember, this is an old preacher writing to a young preacher, a young man in the ministry that's began in his ministry or is in his ministry. And all the admonitions to him are very appropriate for us today as well as children of God as we take our lives and perform and form them into what Christ would have them to be. So, first thing he says to him, young man, you be strong. Be strong. Nobody wants to be around a wimp, okay? Be strong. And the things that thou hast heard, now even if you don't feel like you're strong, be strong anyhow. Make like you're strong. Act like you're strong. Look like you're strong. Okay? And the thing, you can cry when you get home. When you're out, but be strong. The things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same. Commit thou to faithful men. That's the second phrase. Commit thou to faithful men. And that's our focus as we look at this series of 10 different resolutions. It might work for 2017. And we've got 3 more to go. So we're going to be, hopefully we'll get them by June anyhow. So you have the last part of 17 covered. Commit thou to faithful men. And that's what I'm going to talk about this morning. And that's the focus of our lesson this morning, is investing your life in other people. Who shall be able to teach others also? That's why you invest in them. So that they can teach others, and then in turn they can teach others, and so on. Verse 3. Thou therefore, and here's the third phrase, endure hardness. Now get over your pitiful self and endure hardness. Life's going to be tough. Things are going to come your way. People are going to be ugly to you. Just get over it, suck it up, and go on. You're a child of God. Act like one. Endure hardness, he says. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. Who called you to be a soldier? Christ did. It wasn't your idea to get saved. It was God's idea for you to get saved. Okay? He's the one that convicted you of your sins. If he hadn't spoken to your heart, you'd still be an old lost sinner bound for hell. So he called you. He's the one that enlisted you in his army. Verse 5. Here's your fourth phrase, or your fourth word, strive. And if any man also strive, okay, are you beginning to see what the picture is here? Christian life requires some efforts on our part, and sometimes it gets tough. And just because it gets tough doesn't give us an excuse to let up, does it? We have to keep on plugging, amen? Just like when you're on that football field pulling in that old elastic band, you just got to keep on pulling, right, Chris? You can't let up on it. Okay. And if any man also strive for mastery, yet he is not crowned except he strive lawfully. Okay? There are standards that we operate within parameters of. So, look at the next verse, and we'll see our fifth word. The husbandman that laboreth. You see, the thought continues. We're to be strong. We're to commit to faithful. We're to commit things to faithful men. We're to mentor somebody, in other words. We're to endure hardness. We're to strive. We're to labor. Must be partakers. Must be first partakers of the fruit. Yeah, you got to know what you've got before you can sell it to anybody. Verse 7, consider then, here's the next thing. You're striving, you're working. Now think about what I say. Consider what I say, Paul says to young Timothy. And the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. And then, here's your next word, remember. So be strong, commit, endure hardness, strive, labor, consider. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David, and here's the glorious crown of it all, was raised, just like these candidates did, were raised out of the water this morning. He was raised from the dead according to my gospel, Paul says. Father, would you honor your word? Would you speak to our hearts this morning? Teach us what we need to learn, Father, and encourage us, I pray, through this message this morning, to be determined to invest our lives in other people so they can grow and they can grow others, and consequently the kingdom of God will grow and thy kingdom will come in this earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated. One of the things that I have had to deal with over the years as a pastor, and I'm sure you other pastors in here can identify with the same thing, is people that think they have arrived and that they no longer have to study or pray or work. There are some of you in here today that think you're there. Let me make this statement. There's not a single person in here, and the good part about being my age, there's not many of you in here that are older than I am. And let me tell you what, I am nowhere near arrived yet spiritually. If you think I have, you ask my wife. She'll tell you he has not arrived. And sometimes he falls far shorter than he does at other times. But any of you that think that you have arrived in here, you are probably in greater danger than Jim. Jim's just 2 weeks old. You're probably, those of you that have been saved since you were 8, 9, 10, 5, 6 years old, are probably, and you think you've arrived spiritually. There's nothing that you have to learn. You don't have to study anymore. It's all right if you don't pray, because then God's got it going on. You're probably in bigger trouble and in greater danger of failing than the newest born Christian there is in this place. We've not arrived yet, guys. None of us have been glorified yet. Until we get glorified, we've still got a ways to go. Every last one of us, myself included. Probably me more than anybody. Let me tell you, never stop learning, never stop growing, and never, ever stop sharing. Every day that I live, the more that I understand that I have one bottom line, and that's getting people saved.
Right.
Jim and I were talking in the new member orientation this morning that if Jesus Christ comes today, the only thing that's going to make any difference in the lives of everyone that I've engaged in my 73 years here on this earth, the only thing that's going to make any difference is whether or not that person's born again. Doesn't matter if I build them a house, if I've given them a car, if I've built a home, if I've sent them to college, if I've sent them through vocations, it doesn't matter what I've done for them. The only thing that's going to matter when the trumpet sounds is whether or not they've been born again. Nothing else matters. Nothing else matters, praise God. And that's all. And folks, we have got to continue sharing and investing in others.
Oh, yeah.
I visit today the way I do because of Barbara's Uncle Charles, who was an old retired Methodist pastor that they called back into active service to pastor a little five-point charge up on the North Carolina-Tennessee line. And Uncle Charles asked me to help him, and I preached two times on Sunday morning. At one church, at two churches, and then I'd go to the next church. The next Sunday, I'd preach at two more churches, and Uncle Charles and I, one church would have to do without a service every third Sunday. They didn't have one because there's only two preachers. We could only preach twice on Sunday morning. I'd preach one at 9 o'clock, and then I'd go preach one at 11 o'clock. And the funny part, the first one that Uncle Charles sent us to, and then this is, I'm chasing rabbits, but old men do that. And we went to this church, and we sat there for, it was supposed to start like at 9, I guess. And we sat there, and the three people came in, this man, his wife, and daughter. And so we sat there, and you folks that have been here a while, you've heard me tell this story, I'm sure. But we sat there for a while, about 10, 15 minutes after start time. Finally, the man said, "Preacher, I don't know what you're waiting on," but said, "We're the congregation." That's all, we're all we're in. And so we just jumped right in that little, I preached. I preached just like the house was full.
I
flew loose. But anyhow, God blessed in that little old church. And it wasn't just a few weeks till that church there was not room in it to see. God blessed that little old place. I'm telling you what's the truth. Listen, because there was a man that invested in my life. My dad, for all my life, had set up and taught me the Bible and everything. And Uncle Charles thought enough of me to teach me how to interact with Methodists. And that's a challenge. Just kidding, you Methodists. But I'm telling you, he invested in my life. I keep my records today. When you go to my office, if you look on my bookshelf, and you look in the right book, you'll see a book that records everywhere I've ever preached since I started preaching. There's a book that records everywhere, every passage of scripture I've taken. There's a drawer. There's probably 40 or 50 pounds of notes that I've made on every sermon I've ever preached. The notes are still there. They're all refined because Jim Mizell, pastor of First Baptist Church in Spruce Pine, thought enough about me to invest every week in me. And him pastoring a church that had four or five times the members. One, matter of fact, your pastor that was here before me, Rocky, is pastoring that same church today. The pastor of that church, Dr. Jim Mizell, took me under his wing as a young preacher and invested in me and taught me how to keep records and how to, sometimes people say they didn't do a good job, but how to conduct myself in the pulpit, one thing to another, like that. And he and my dad, what I'm saying is, folks, I'm the man that I am today. I visit hospitals and hang out with people having surgery because my dad, an old Baptist preacher, when anyone was sick or whatever, my dad was right there. So, I mean, I am today what I am because of men that have invested in my life.
All right.
Now, here's a question for you men and women. How many are there in your life, or is there anyone in your life that you are intentionally, listen to me, every one of you, don't think about dinner, knock it off. Confound it, I'm not through yet. Every one of you, every single one of you, I don't care how old you are, anything else about you. How many of you in here have some person in the world somewhere that you're investing your life in? Oh, I'm too busy. Then you need to get unbusy.
Right.
Because we're to decide. This is a commandment in verse 2, the young preacher, and we're all supposed to do it. If you're too busy, I guarantee you there's not a person in here, not a single person in here that works more hours a week than I do. I promise you that.
Thank you, darling. God bless you.
And I love to spend time with people.
Oh, yeah.
There's not a Sunday morning goes by that I don't invest in several young preachers' lives before I even get out of the house and come over here at 7 o'clock in the morning to begin praying in this building with Sam. We pray over this whole building every Sunday, and that building, and all the rooms, and everything like that. But before I even come out the door, before light even breaks on Sunday morning, I'm investing in men's life. I'm telling you this, I don't want any praise or glory. I'm just telling you what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
And I don't ask you to do something I don't do. And I've got to preach. You know, I've got to preach at least twice on Sunday, besides everything else that I'm supposed to do, you know. And I'm telling you that there's nothing that's any more important to me than investing in people's lives.
That's right.
Because when you walk into a church that you hadn't been in 20 years, and as soon as you walk in, a very distinguished man walks up to you with tears in his eyes and said, I just want to thank you for what you did in my life. It kind of makes it worthwhile, folks. And that's what makes the kingdom of God grow. Now, I'm not bragging on myself. Sounds like I am. I mean, that's all right. Just get over it. I just lost my reward for letting you know. But I'm just telling you, I'm asking you to do what I'm already doing. Every one of you. Have you ever stopped to think, oh, this is good. Have you ever stopped to think that the quality and success of Clear Creek Baptist Church in the future depends on how and if the young ones here are trained?
Right.
Just because this church has been here 150 plus years doesn't mean it's going to be 150 more if you guys don't invest in somebody's life.
Right.
Do you ever wonder why there's not more kids running around here and more young people running around here than what they are? It's because we're not investing in their lives like we ought to be.
Right.
When I die and I come hovering around here as a specter 100 years from now, I want to see this place packed out, and I want this building to be seating about 20,000 people. Amen. God's building all these fields around here full of houses. Why do you reckon he's doing that?
Right.
To give us a field to draw from to grow the kingdom of God. One of the greatest resolutions that you can make for 2017 would be to mentor someone during the year 2017. Folks, listen. Oh, this is good too. I can't believe God gives me all this good stuff. I am a child of God. John 1:12 said, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become, what?
Amen.
Sons of God. Listen to this. The kingdom of God is my Father's business. And you can call God Daddy if you want to, but I'm not comfortable with that informality. That's God Almighty. And you do whatever you want to with that. I'm leaving that alone. But my Father has a kingdom, and my Father has a business. And his bottom line is souls. And I want to be involved in my Father's business because guess what? I'm going to inherit that business one of these days. Did you realize that? You're working towards your inheritance when you're working for the kingdom of God. And you're sitting on your duff and don't have time to invest in someone, really? That's your Father's business, man. And you're going to inherit something. I wouldn't be surprised if you don't write some of y'all will. Just kidding. But I mean, there's something to think about, isn't it? It's his business. He can do with it as he pleases. As a son of God, I'm concerned about my father's business.
Amen.
And I'm going to do what I can to make it grow. Okay, now. So now we're to the outline. That was the introduction. Introduction is probably better than the sermon, really. Verse number one. Now this is what Paul is addressing to his young steward about being involved in his father's business. Verse one, he says, and I already addressed this, but I want to address it again. Be strong in grace. And this is where you get the way Paul puts this. And we talk about in our men's Bible study on Thursday, we talk about the ability to be strong and to be what God would have us to be. Isn't it interesting that Paul doesn't say to Timothy, now, son, you be strong and buck up and you do what's right. You've got the grace and the strength in you to do that. He doesn't say that. Why? Because Timothy and you do not have the grace and strength within you to buck up and do that.
Right, that's right.
You think you can do it right and never make a mistake and everything. You just try to do it in your own strength and see how bad you fall short.
Yeah.
That's why he says to young Timothy, son, you be strong in the grace.
Right.
You know, when it gets hard and it gets tough and you depend on the grace of God. You can't do it yourself. You just fall on his grace. You're determined to do what's right and depend on God and let God do it through you. As we said, you can do anything God can do because God's working through you. It's God that does it and not you.
Right.
Wow. Be strong in grace. You can't. So, but he can. By his grace, he can do it through you. Dealing with daily life. How about when you get so discouraged that you don't know what to do? Preachers, and this is a true statement, and I didn't really realize it till I pastored some churches I've pastored. Sometimes you just want to quit on Monday morning. It's not the way with this church, but I've pastored churches. Pastors, can you say amen? Sometimes, matter of fact, sometimes we don't even want to wait until Monday morning, do we? I'm telling you, sometimes you just, what time? I don't have a clock, so I mean, I'm okay today. I can stay as long as I want. We were down in Charleston one time. No? Yeah, well, anyhow, sometimes you just want to quit.
Yeah, amen.
I'll just leave it there. I wound up in a bar, but I wasn't drinking, okay? But anyhow, it was on Sunday afternoon, too. I mean, Sunday morning had been rough. You remember that? When the storm came. Now, anyhow, I will tell you, too. And we were out on the beach, and a storm came up. It was storming. And we were over on the Isle of Palms, and we went the closest walkway in. I think I've told somebody this story before. And we went into the bar, and we just wanted to get in and out of the storm. It was bad. So we were standing there. Everybody else had thought the same thing. So there were no seats. So Barbara had to go to the bathroom, you know. So she went to the bathroom. But while she's gone, two people left the bar. There's some tables, but there's a bar. So I sat down, and as soon as they left, I just jumped right in the seat. And I went, well, there was 3 or 4 empty beer bottles sitting there. Barbara came out of the bathroom and it was not pretty. I'll just say, I'm not going to say what she said or anything. I'm not going to say anything about the bouncer throwing me out, called my wife was ugly. I'm just going to say it wasn't pretty when she came out of the bathroom and saw those empty beer bottles sitting there. She said, I know Sunday morning was rough, but it wasn't that bad. But anyhow, I'm just telling you, folks, life's going to get tough sometimes, and you can stick with it by the grace of God. You can't do it in yourself, but by the grace of God, you can stick with it. Life gets tough. You deal with discouragement, but you stick with the stuff. People are not inspired by weakness, guys. They need to see strength. Number two. I think I'll skip number two and then come back to two. Well, that's where I kind of want to sit down. Verse number three says, be tough. So here's two things. Now, in between being strong and being tough, Paul says to Timothy, share this with people. So let me talk about tough just a little bit. And then I'll go back to verse two, and we'll kind of finish up with that. I've already talked about the other verses. I'm just going to leave them alone. But there's two things. And in between those two things is where Paul told Timothy, I want you to commit. I want you to invest in them. I want you to impress other men and women. I want you to impress other women with your strength and with your toughness. I want them to see what a man or woman of God's supposed to look like. We don't want any sap-sucking a sugar tit needing people that just waddles around, walks around with a mule face religion, dragging their tail 20 feet behind them. We need somebody that's got some strength.
Amen.
That stands up and acts like God's somebody, because God is somebody.
Amen.
But the reason you're such a failure is because you don't have any faith, you shall.
Right. Come on,
amen.
Amen. Amen.
That's usual, friend. Boy, they'll all come back next Sunday. I'm telling you guys, God expects men and women to stand up and be men and women of God.
Right.
And that's why Paul puts toughness and strength before and after this statement that we need to invest in. Aren't you glad your children are back there and not hearing some of the words you're preaching? That's why they go to children's church. That preacher, you can't. Be tough, verse 3 says. Be therefore, but thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Satan will attack you, and he'll use other people to attack you. Isn't it amazing that Satan never comes to you with his horns and his tail and his pitchfork? It's always some whiny Christian that's not got enough man or woman about him to stand up and be a man or woman of God that's causing you trouble. Satan works through other people, and they will attack you. And Paul says, Timothy, son, you be tough. That word attack, endure hardness, means, and it's interesting, they're two different words spelled totally different, but they both come from the same Greek root, which means hardship, to be afflicted, endure afflictions, or to suffer trouble. Matter of fact, right there in the next page, 2 Timothy 4 and 5, it says, But watch thou in all things. Endure afflictions. It doesn't say if afflictions come. No, you just watch. They're coming, dude.
Right.
You just watch. They're coming. Endure afflictions. Do the work of an evangelist and make full proof of thy ministry. Witness, in other words, what he's saying is you stick with the stuff till the end.
Right.
Just stick with the stuff till the end. Amen. You see. Bottom line, you are teaching others by example and intentionally. So stick with it. Jesus said, you did not choose me, but what? I have chosen you.
Right.
So if it's Jesus that did the choosing as a soldier, then you were enrolled by Christ. In other words, you were drafted in his army. He's the one that enrolled you. He's the one that trained you. Oh, I like that. God has invested a lot in your life. And this gets back to the sharing. Every event, listen to me, every event, good and bad, that's happened in your life was part of God's equipping and training you to be and do what he has in mind for you to do. I was thinking about that this morning, and I remembered an unpleasant event in my life, like when I was 2 or 3 years old, I remembered that event this morning and how unpleasant it was. And God showed me this morning how God used that and has used that all of my life to help mold the character. It's one of the elements of in the character development of myself today. Everything in my life, did you know that every second of your life has been planned by God, and God has been concerned about that, and he has injected those seconds and those events into your life so God could train you and make you what you are today?
Amen.
Yeah, and you thought you were just messed up and screwed everything. No, you did, but he knew he planned it. You can't outguess God, because he already knows what you're going to do, so he's already made a plan. So the way that you're doing is the best that God could possibly do, because he's in control of your life, by the way. So thank you, Jesus. He's invested a lot in us. He enrolled you, he trained you, he armed you, and he's the one that supports you. Thought of another good illustration, but I'm not using it. God's relationship with you is real, personal, and what is it, guys?
Right.
Practical. Amen. Amen. Elisha. God sent him out with the ravens. No, it's Elijah, wasn't it?
Elijah.
You think about that. He had a relationship with God, didn't he?
Right. He
not only sent him out and protected him, he gave him water to drink, and he sent a blamed old buzzard, crows, ravens, yeah, birds of prey, that eat old rotten stuff to bring him a bologna sandwich at lunch every day. Or something,
man.
You know, I mean, brought him something.
Right.
I mean, God's practical, guys.
Amen.
He cares about. He's not going to throw you out there. You say, "Well, I don't have the resources to do what God told me. I'm not smart enough. Yep, you're not. But he made you just like you are. And if he tells you to do something, he's going to do it. And if God does something to you that you can't do, guess who gets the glory?
Right.
What's it about? That's what's about. Since you are enrolled as a soldier, you need to determine then, verse 3, endure hardness. You need to suffer, you need to determine that you're going to suffer hardships if it's necessary. Paul says, I've learned in whatever state I am to be content. Shipwrecked, beat, dead, that don't matter, I'm happy. You know. Face danger if it comes, you need to determine that you're going to face danger if it comes. You need to determine to leave home and comfort if called to do so. I can't go where it's too dangerous over there. And I'll tell you where it's dangerous. It ain't no bar. It's when you're out of God's will. That's where the danger is. Bind yourself to and obey. We, me and Barb, telling the PDAP being killed several times. The only reason we wasn't is because God wasn't ready for us to go. Bind yourself to and obey your commander in chief. That's what you need to do. Be tough, okay? Now let's go back to verse 2. And I'm almost through. I'm glad. Well, now that was nice of y'all to be quiet when I said that. Joe about fell out. What'd you drop? Don't Joe do a good job? I'm very much good. I mean, we had to change order service this morning. He just jumps in there like an old trooper. Thank the Lord for Joe, your blessing. And for Maggie, thank the Lord for our staff here. And God's just blessed us so much. And everyone, and all of you guys too. By the way, now let's get back to verse 2 and we'll finish up real quick. And the things that thou hast heard now, I want you to be strong, I want you to be tough, and the things that you've heard among many witnesses, I want you to commit thou to faithful men. Okay, I want you, in other words, here's the heart of the message. I want you to teach the things that you've learned to other people. Now I want to ask you again. How many of you in here this morning, I don't want you to raise your hands because you would be bragging and everybody else would be embarrassed. And there wouldn't be but two or three of you in here. But how many of you in here are intentionally investing your life in other people? In other people. Amen. Intentionally investing your life in other people today. The newest Christian raises his hand. Isn't that something? Folks, we've got to do that. Amen. Do you realize that if every person in here that's here this morning, if every one of you would pick out a person that God leads you to. And I tell you how to pick out. Pick out the least likely person that you can find. And start investing your life, your time in that person, calling them, taking them cookies, taking them out to eat, inviting them to church every week. In less than 6 months, this church would double. In less than 6 months. If every person here, I challenged our church to do that one time. And Barbara and I chose an old alcoholic up on the hill that everybody said, there's no way that you're going to get him in church. No way. He leaves on Monday morning, and as soon as the VA opens, he goes. VA? No. VFW. As soon as the VFW opens, he goes, and he drinks all day. And the next day, he goes, and he drinks. Nice of guys you'd want to meet, but you'll never get him in church. How long was it that we had him in church? Him and his wife. Two or three months. That guy that everybody said, nobody getting in church. So we picked us out another one. That 1 year, just with that effort, besides the door-to-door visitation stuff, just that 1 year, mine and Barbara's efforts engaging one person or one family. And I hope I'm not wrong, but I think we got three families in that year in our church. And that church and the people in the church bought into the thing, and man, God just blessed it. I'm just busted it the same. Investing in people's lives. People want to know that someone cares.
Amen.
And God wants his kingdom to grow. And it's not his will that any perish but all come to repent. So find you the biggest, ugliest, nicest, meanest sinner you can find and start loving on them. And God will do a miracle in their life.
Amen. Right.
Paul told Timothy, you'll do that, son. That's the heart of the message. You've learned from many others, among many witnesses, it said. Look around the church here. Look at Brother Don sitting there, all smug and snug in the rug, like an old bug in the rug. think about the influence that he's had on you guys. How many of you in here today are the men and women you are because of the influence of Don? Just raise your hand. That's what I'm talking about. Just about 50% of the hands in the church went up, Brother Don. That's what I'm talking about. Folks, he's invested in people's lives and he loves on people. And people watch him and he's consistent and he's not by himself.
Right.
I mean, our deacon board, Larry and Sam and Paul and any of you want to call here, the guys that live the consistent, daily, godly lives here, Brother Brooks, and the many of them here. And young people that God's put in our church that are growing it today, man, we are the example to people, Lord. Mercy on us, and you don't do it like this shit. Just look around the church. He says, among many witnesses, so there are many. Now you take that same knowledge and strength and stuff that you have gained just by those that are around you, though, among many witnesses, and show that and share that with them, the same that they have with you. Now, again, God has invested a lot in your life.
That's right.
Oh, man. Boy. Has he ever invested a lot in your life? Now, you go out and do the same. Here we go. Mentoring requires sacrifice.
Right.
Y'all busy? Who's not busy anymore?
That's right.
Absolutely busy. I had a pastor call me this morning. After I'd already done the text and the encouraging and all that kind of stuff, I had a pastor call me this morning and said, "Good question." And I said, "What is it?" And this pastor is bivocational. I have several bivocational pastors that I love and work with and everything. And he said, "I have a question for him." Here was his question. He said, "I have to go pick up one handicapped person and another single mom and her two children to bring them to church this morning. And I always have one of the men in the church to go with me, and he's not here this week. What do I need to do?" And you know the thought come to my mind, you need to go to church, you need to get your ball back, you need to call all the men in the church up in front of the church, and you need to start beating on their heads. You working 40, 50 hours a week on a job, pastoring a church, visiting, praying, and studying, and you have to go pick up people on Sunday morning? You need to work on the church. I didn't tell him that. But that was the thought that came to my mind. Why in the name of the Lord doesn't someone in the church recognize that the pastor needs some help?
Amen.
And step up and start investing in people's lives? I told him, go on by yourself. As long as you've got two or three in the car, you're good to go. You know, wow. You got someone to prove it, you know. That's what I'm thinking, guys. The point is we need to invest in other people's lives. Oh, this is good. Here's your resolution that goes with the T under resolution if you're staying up with that acronym or acrostic or whatever you want to call it. T, resolve to teach. I'd rather use the word mentor. Resolve to mentor someone this year. Resolve to intentionally invest in someone's life this year. I think about G. Campbell Morgan. I'm going to close with this. Barb, you can come on the piano if you don't mind, sweetie, and get ready. G. Campbell Morgan received a letter one time from a guy that was converted under his ministry. He talked about coming in service of a poor little neglected boy and all and hungry and all that. But anyhow, in that service, he saw that preacher. And he was so inspired with that preacher that he made up his mind that he someday wanted to be a preacher like he was. And y'all have heard the stories about Spurgeon chasing the kids down on the streets, that crazy preacher, you know, from the tabernacle and come and chase him down because they missed church. And, you know, but he was so inspired by G. Campbell Morgan, so he said, "I want to be like him." And he wrote him a letter later. Not only did he grow up and become a preacher, but his son became a preacher of the gospel as well. And he wrote Dr. Morgan a letter. I don't know if he's a doctor or not, but he wrote G. Campbell Morgan a letter, Reverend Morgan a letter. And this is what he said. "From the night," listen to this, men and women, "from the night that you became my great human ideal, I think I have read every book that you have written. I placed your picture on the flyleaf of my Bible, and I have never stood to preach without first turning to look upon it. It somehow helps me more than anything else." Now I know you're holy, and you're saying, "Well, he had that picture of Jesus on the Bible." Well, go stick it in your head in the sand. You get over yourself. The point is, that man inspired that child enough until he was an inspiration for him all his life. Of course God called him to preach. Of course God called his son to preach. Of course, God blessed all the souls that were saved, but there was a man that cared enough for that kid to invest his life in him until that kid became a great man of God. Here's the challenge. I don't like to use the word challenge. Here's the opportunity for you. Someday, if Jesus doesn't come, they're going to roll your old, dead, decaying body down this aisle here.
Right.
And they're going to fix it up so it's pretty, but it ain't. It's already started rotting in the moment God called breath out of your life. Is there going to be anyone in the congregation that says, that man, that woman, they made a difference in my life? To me, the most pathetic thing in the world would be to live your life and die and it not make any difference.
That's right.
Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for your words from the lips of an old pastor to a young preacher boy. And I thank you for how those same words challenge us today. I pray that they've challenged us or encouraged us to take advantage of the opportunities to intentionally invest our life in others. Father, I pray that even through this experiencing God group, that there will be 4 or 5 or 6 men that will come out of that and say, I believe God wants me to lead a group through that or through some other study. Father, so that we're investing in others' lives. Even this morning, Lord, when I mentioned identifying someone in your realm of acquaintance that's not in church and beginning to invest in their life, you brought people's names to the mind of some of the folks sitting in this congregation. I pray that they would make that commitment, either come to the mourner's bench, to the altar, and pray a commitment to you, or right where they're sitting. But Lord, I pray that this message would make a difference in their life as we go on. Bless us and use us. Father, may we always give you praise and honor and glory for everything that's done. Never realize, never think in a moment for a second that we do anything in our own strength, but only grow stronger in your grace, Lord. Strong in the grace of God. Bless the invitation now, I pray in Jesus' name.